Good evening and welcome everyone at National Smart Cities Conclave. We are here for the panel discussion 5, Intelligent, Safe and Equitable Urban Mobility. I would like to introduce... So now I would like to introduce our moderator for this panel discussion, Shri Vivek Ogra, Partner Leader, Transport Consulting, ENY. I welcome you, Vivek.
Thank you, Faranji. Viewers, welcome to this very exciting panel, which is on intelligent, safe, and equitable urban mobility.
Let me invite all the speakers, and then we'll start.
Sure.
So now we have with us Ms. Ankita Kar, Managing Director, Mass Rapid Transit Corporation, UT of Jammu and Kashmir. Welcome, Ankita, ma'am.
Thank you so much for having me today, Farhan. And I believe today's discussion is going to be very interesting. Urban mobility is a topic very close to my heart, and I believe we will talk a lot more. It's good to see you, Mr. Ogra.
Thank you, ma'am.
EY is, well known. So I'm looking forward. Let's have the discussion.
Thank you.
Now I would like to invite Shri Nilkantha Pomanji, Joint Chief Executive Director, Pimpri Chinchwad Smart City Limited. Welcome, Mr. Poman.
Good evening, everyone. So I am very grateful that I am here in this discussion, because Pimpri Chinchwad is going to implement a smart traffic and transport system. Thank you.
Now I would invite Shri Nilesh R, Senior Urban Director, NIUA. Welcome, Nileji.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me here. And it's a pleasure. I've had the opportunity to work on the Delhi Master Plan for 2041. And I hope I can share some of our insights that we got during the plan preparation for mobility particularly, and how it shapes cities and planning in general. So thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. And we have more speakers in Chetan Nandani, Shri Raj Cherubal, and Dr. Rohit Bansal. They are joining us shortly. So once they'll join, I will introduce them. Over to you, Vivekji.
Thank you, Farhan. So I think we have an interesting and exciting topic to discuss today, and it relates to us every day. We touch the systems every day in different ways. Intelligent, safe, and equitable urban mobility does mean that the cities and the transport systems allow us to make smarter choices when it comes to traveling in the cities. Most of the time, when you look at smart mobility in that sense, we think it is all about technology per se. But my view is, technology does deliver the eventual outcomes, but it is about the holistic smartness in the system that takes us to the final line. When we look at systems such as governance in the transport system, we look at operations and maintenance, we look at the sensors that are required in the construction activity, and so on and so forth, we would really imagine that, the whole universe gets together in the system to deliver that one right choice that the user wants to take at that right time. With that, I think, we need to be cognizant of the fact that, we're dealing with a very, very diverse set of users in transport system. India being a country which has a hugely diversified socioeconomic profile in our cities, and hence, how do we ensure that we're able to deliver these intelligent choices to all walks of the society? How are we making sure that it is safe to be operated by people with different abilities? And eventually, how is it equitable, not just from the perspective of access, but in terms of ability for each and everyone to use the system? I would really feel that, the eventual outcomes of a smarter mobility systems are better user experiences to people who have different abilities, better infrastructure and smarter infrastructure, which is able to, relay back smarter choices to the people who are maintaining and delivering those systems. The networks of the future, how do we really ensure that we're reaching right places for the right purpose? We are rendering safe operating environments to people. Different cities have different safety requirements. In general, the systems have to be safe to operate. We are integrated in nature. I think, you know, one of the most talked about requirement in our cities is how do we ensure that our cities move in an integrated manner, which is that different components of the transportation systems deliver as one, not just as individual systems. Sustainability is at the core of smarter mobility, and hence how sustainable choices are being made to ensure that we are making our cities future-proof. And eventually, I think all of this has to culminate into a fact that, you know, it has to enable us to make future choices which are right. With that, I think stage set for the discussion for this evening. I'm aware that this is Friday evening, and we will ensure that, you know, it's going to be as exciting to ensure that it delivers the Friday evening to you. With that, I would start with Ankita ma'am. A very important question on integrated systems. And since you are, managing MRTS for Srinagar, I think the city has always been seen as a very fragmented transportation ecosystem, a lot of it being delivered by private operators and so on and so forth, which are also in the paratransit space. How are you looking at this holistic change getting delivered to the city as a smarter system eventually, which will be used by all?
Thank you, Mr. Ogra. So let me just give a little bit of introduction to the corporation that I am managing. I am the managing director of MRTC, which is basically Mass Rapid Transit Corporation. Interestingly, the corporation had in mind that transportations cannot exist in isolation. There has to be intermodal solution, because urban planning is, as we all know, in India, urban planning is something we have started a bit late, right? So things have already probably grown into this urban masses, wherein if we just take solitary approaches, we will probably not be able to do justice to the whole integration plan. So when my corporation was formed in the year 2019, the thought behind it was that we will bring intermodal integration. Having said that, what is the most new approach to having a good urban mobility? How do we ensure good public transportation? There are a lot of benefits that a metro system is set to have, you know, and in my little conversation with you, I would actually like to mention some of them and what we plan to do. Further, what I would really want everyone listening to me today to understand that it doesn't stop, public transport does not stop at metro systems. It is a whole ambit wherein there has to be appropriate feeder routes to the metro system. If metro system is like a whole backbone to a city, there has to be road network complementing it. There have to be NMVs, non-motorized routes, which have to complement that. As well as there have to be much more, we could even think about inland waterways, which I believe Srinagar has a beautiful spine in the nature of River Jhelum. And giving you a little bit of a background of the kind of work we've done, right? We have actually tried to get together a comprehensive mobility plan, which is a requirement that the government of India, according to the Metro Policy of 2017, says that it has to be there. You know, you just cannot say that our city requires a metro. You have to give a whole idea of what is your mobility plan. And hence, in the comprehensive mobility plan of Srinagar, we have a lot of interesting ideas which we have captured. I believe as we move forward with this panel discussion, some of them will be out. I will not, go ahead with all the discussion in one go. I'll let Mr. Ogra ask me those questions to sort of bring out the best, So I believe it is definitely that Srinagar, you know, as we all know, Srinagar is a mix of old values, ancient values, and new aspirations. It's a beautiful city which has its own dynamic, vibrant sort of a character, which is so unique to itself. A lot of people have asked me this question. Are you planning to convert Srinagar into some kind of an urban jungle? You know, will it look nice with the whole metro circuit? My question to everyone who will ask me this question is, Can you imagine in the year 2050, when we do not have something, you know, it's business as usual. There is an interesting term which urban mobility planners, I'm sure Mr. Ogra agrees with me, and everyone in the panelists agree with me. Business as usual. We don't do anything. We just sit without project, right? What happens? The number of private vehicles increase. In fact, I have some interesting figures here as well. You know, the number of private vehicles increase, you know, maybe commercialization, you know, in particular corridors increase, the intensity of, you know, the vehicular traffic. So are we ready to take all of that? I mean, isn't it better that we have a whole backbone of a beautiful urban road net, you know, like a metro network, which has its feeders, you know? So a planning is required is what I personally believe. And let's hear a bit more and then we'll come up with maybe more ideas. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I think it's you touched upon the absolute right points. You know, how are we making our cities relevant to future? How are we making people take right choices by giving them the right systems? I think metro does make a lot of sense in terms of. I think, you know, it's also very relevant to Srinagar because of the right of way issues that we have, and you know, the increasing the population of vehicle. Increase is tremendous in Srinagar city. How do we really, you know, move away from a situation of such a beautiful city and not moving at the right pace? I think you made the right, you know, choices in that sense. I'll come back to you, ma'am, with one more question. Meanwhile, let me go to Mr. Raj Cherubal, who is CEO of Chennai Smart City. Welcome to the panel, sir.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Chennai is implementing a lot of initiatives from intelligent transportation perspective. I know there are a lot of programs underway which are funded to ensure there is intelligent mobility. It renders the city in a state that is moving rightly. There is a lot of technology and infrastructure being built. So how would you really, you know, say that intelligent systems are going to deliver for future, and how is it going to change the user experience? Because at the end of the day, all of the systems that we're going to put in place should render the right user experience. That is going to eventually move to the modal shift situation.
So I think, first of all, thank you so much. It's a very, very important topic, obviously, especially now that the whole world is talking about climate change and whatnot. So luckily for Chennai, we had, as a city, we had started discussing these topics almost 10 or 12 years ago. And like all other cities, we struggle. And earlier speakers were correct that, you know, urban planning, everything is in bits and pieces. It's everything is in silo. So here's where I will start off by saying, take a simple junction. If there's a junction is crowded in an advanced city, In India, for example, what they do is they say, okay, who's the owner of the road, which is a corporation or a highway? And they say, hey, do something about it. And the only thing they are able to say is that let's put a flyover, right? Or let's widen the road. But no matter how much you widen the road, the problem of that junction didn't start in that junction. It's not like magically cars appeared in the junction. Those cars came from somewhere else. People came from somewhere else and crowded that junction. An advanced city looks at it very differently. So it says, okay, they have planning layer, they have bus layer, the metro rail layer, and so on and so forth. So they're able to say that junction crowd came from all these different places, and shall we put more buses from there? Shall we, next metro rail line should go through those places so that they can pick up people and bring here. But very importantly, they also look at carrot and stick. Carrot would be the better footpath, better buses, better metro rail, public transport, and so on. The stick is the parking management system. Some places, even like London, has congestion charges. They have enforcement so that you can't simply sit in the middle of the junction and or cut red light, etc. So many layers have to work together for proper Hong Kong to function, or a Shanghai or a New York to function. So Chennai, we are attempting in strategic pieces. That's how I would put it, that we can't do everything overnight, obviously. We don't have the capacity. But some strategic pieces have happened in Chennai. So, for example, for the last 2 years or so, we were implementing a very difficult but a very useful parking management system. The idea is that you, the car driver, should be able to figure out where the parking is open in any part of the city. It's an app based and all that. But then when you go there, the camera or sensor based tells the system integrator that, hey, somebody's parked there, so somebody come and collect money from you, or you can pay electronically. Similarly, we have a very well-received, very smart bike system, so that it's very popular with all kinds of people, young people and elderly. And even during after the COVID, again, the popularity has gone up because people find it very useful from exercise and for travel purpose. Of course, we have Metro Rail, and we have a pretty decent bus system, but we have a long way to go, obviously. There's a lot of emphasis on footpaths, and again, long way to go. The footpaths are not perfect, but at least the awareness of footpath being very important and a building block to the city is very important. But all this to happen, these are pieces, building blocks of the city, I would say. But then very importantly, I think Chennai is now, Tamil Nadu government is implementing something called the CUMTA, that is the Chennai Unified Metropolitan Transport Authority. There'll be a massive amount of funds going through CUMTA and staffing, properly staffed. So as part of the World Bank City Partnership, CUMTA has established. And quite a bit of study has happened to figure out what are the staffing requirement, what is the technological requirement. So that's number one. Two, just now we have floated a tender for a massive intelligent transportation system, which involves the police piece, the traffic police piece, and the bus piece. So police piece is basically five junctions, four junctions, you should be able to go smoothly in greens. And then you stop only very little in a next junction. But to make this happen, obviously, you need sensors across the city, beyond the city, actually, CMA areas, Chennai metropolitan area. But the implementation will be around 165 junction. So you should be able to figure out that, okay, which is the best way to go to the airport or wherever you're going. And then the city, the intelligence has enough data about all the different junctions, etc., at the junction level for it to start controlling where it's crowded, which should get more green, where should you get more red and all that, which automatically means that you can start giving bus priority. And I'll get to the bus piece, but you can start giving green corridor for VIPs, ambulances, and so on. So pretty much what you would see in an advanced city, we are hoping that we'll be able to implement in the coming year or two. Then there's the bus piece. Basically, from a user point of view, it's like, okay, when is my next bus coming? In an app or in a bus stop, you should be able to figure out when the bus is coming. But to make it happen, you need depot management, fleet management, all kinds of other pieces of software and electronics that need to be happening behind the scene, including something called an onboard computer in a bus, so that if a bus driver is driving too harsh or braking too harsh or not stopping at the bus stop properly, these are the things a good bus company will monitor a bus to make sure that the entire system is functioning properly. Typically, bus guy will stop somewhere. Not his fault, maybe sometime. Sometime the bus stop is crowded, or sometime he's doing this for the nth time a day. He may go park somewhere else, and then everybody runs behind the bus, instead of coming and picking up the customer. So all this is there. So the effect of all this is going to be pretty tremendous in terms of carbon, in terms of petrol saving, diesel saving, pollution, and so on. I keep joking in every seminar is that, see, today the car company puts an ad in the Facebook or paper and say, hey, buy my car, I'll give you 20% discount in a sari store or in a clothing store. But I've never seen such an ad from a metro rail or a bus company, right? I'm hoping with all these electronics and data with smart ticketing, smart all that, a bus company should be able to say, look, I know you're going every day in the traffic. I know you're burning so much fuel. I know you're causing so much pollution. It's bad for you, bad for everybody else. Why don't you take my AC bus? You can go comfortably from point A to point B, and we will give you 20% off in this restaurant or in that clothing store. I think we need to get to that level, what a Singapore or a Tokyo or whoever else must be doing, so that public feels it's easier to go by public transport, to walk on the street under a nice shade, to take the bus, take the metro rail, etc. Because these are multi-billion dollar investment. A metro rail, for example, is not I'm a big fan of metro rail in Chennai especially, but it's a massive investment. Unless we do all these other pieces, metro rail will be just another investment which is underutilized, right? Of course, metro rail, a third and fourth phase is coming, so I'm sure that'll make a tremendous impact, like just like in Delhi. Delhi's all metro rail, every time I've gone there, it's crowded, which is a very nice thing. But metro rail alone cannot save the city. You need all these carrot and sticks, and then we need to expand our cycle sharing system. We need to bring in common ticketing, for example. I should be able to just get into a bus or get into a metro rail without having to worry about how much change I have in my pocket, or, you know, it's a back-end's problem, how it is dealt with. I as a customer or citizen should be able to just enjoy the transportation system rather than having to worry about when the bus is coming, is it frequent enough and all. Shouldn't be my problem, should be the system's problem, right? So the good news is we have all these different pieces happening, and I hope we will be able to make a difference as a city. It's not just smart city, there's so many other players in the system. Hope we can make a big difference in the coming months.
Thank you so much. I think this is very interesting. Sure. And, you know, that leads me to thinking that, you know, we see a lot of these loyalty points getting to our credit cards and debit cards and whatnot about the spend that we have. Is it time to have a green, miles card, which you can trade for a public transport trip? That's a very interesting concept. I think, you know, something that one should really look at. How can we get to that stage? Thank you so much. I'll certainly come back to you with more questions. Sure. My next question would be to Mr. Neelkantha. You're implementing ITMS in your city, and it has been about two generations in India. We did UBS 1, we did UBS 2. What's your experience of the maturity that the systems are going to now, and hence delivering the right outcomes? Have we reached to a stage where our systems are delivering rightly? And what is your experience in your city, and where are you with that implementation right
now? They have to go away.
Basically, Pimpri Chinchwad transport system is integrated with the Pune city transport system. So Pimpri don't have the independent transport system. Pune is our the sister city. So basically, you are rightly said the intelligent transport mass system. So we have been implemented it 3 to 4 years before, and it is basically working for the BRT system, bus rapid transit system. Now initially it was working on the 4 corridor, and now it is extended to 3 more corridors. So when it is initiated in the year of, I think, 2017-2018, we are facing a lot of challenges, lot of intervention, lot of problems. So we set up the control and command center centrally, and there is some disaster site for these intelligent transport systems in other part of the city. Basically, the system itself is pretty independent, and whether only the bus are transferring to that routes, no other vehicles are transporting these routes. So centrally, it having the location of the fleet, where on the station it stops, how much times it gets to stop, how much total travel or journey. So all these location it gets from the itself to the control center. Bus is also equipped with the all the sensor devices, IoT devices, then CCTV camera, all these surveillance. So it is operated for the system where the long routes are there, where the traffic density times is there. So it is operating well and it is running frequently. But mostly, you can see the in the pandemic system. So pandemic in this COVID, so that was some get affected because of we are not running the whole system as such. So from that, we have started all the fleets routes of the Pune and Pimpri Chinchwad. It is running quite well. In the Pune system, like other cities, the Pune is one of the highest user of the two-wheelers and in the country. And mostly the the mobility happening in this city, that office time mix, so that is same morning 8 to 11 and evening 5 to 8. So these are peak hours for this sister transit system. And in that period, so the traffic congestion is one of the challenges coming in the most of the areas. And that is because of the road widths are not equal in all sizes and all the cities. So we are diversity. We are in the planning of the making this diversify the routes for the one ways, and that is make successful of these transit systems. So the now we are coming to the maturity of the ITMS. So system is now coming to the well maturity, and it is that require some sort of the intelligent agencies, intelligent personnel, those who can handle it properly. So that we are taking in almost all the transport system in India that not financially self-sustainable, they need some help of funding from these various authorities, and that is the crux of this. And lastly, but mostly, so in the transport system, the higher authority, these MDs and all these are not stable. They are going to change by 1 or 2, 3 years. So the whole equation again this changes. But yes, of course, we are behind to running these IT systems very pretty well. And Pune, Pimpri, Chinchwad, having the common mobility plan and this common transport systems. So, and transport authorities also the different from the authorities. Smart city perspective, we are having the signal synchronization system and then the green corridor system. So, which are trying best. We are having the controller based traffic and transport system. So, we are running these not all the signals, but mostly the big signals. So again, the RLVD detection, the police system, so that we are running from the smart cities. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So what I hear is you clearly see a need of now churning the value from the intelligent systems that you have implemented, so that better insights can be delivered for the purpose of delivering better services. And hence, I think what is important that you have got, you should have right kind of insights platform that should be instituted, which can use this huge amount of data that you're creating, which will help you to take right actions to ensure that you're able to deliver intelligent and sustainable decisions on a continual basis. With that, let me go to Mr. Rohit Bansal, who is advisor with Agra Smart City. Agra is a very typical city. I've been to that city several times. It has a confluence of all sort of industries nearby. It has a history which is hugely relevant to the city. Ecologically, it has been always in the news to ensure that we don't see blackening of Taj Mahal and things like that. So I think there have been a lot of initiatives taken around that. Cleanliness is one thing that has been on the focus of the smart city a lot, because tourists and from the relevance of heritage that we have in that city. Now, my question for you is, how are you really using technology to become more sustainable, deliver more sustainable choices, and how are you bringing clean and green initiative within your transport system, and what role is technology playing in that?
Yeah, good evening, everybody. First, I will say thank you for conducting a such kind of important meeting by Fahim, Raman, Farhan, and naturally the moderator Vivekji, that gives you a lot of learning. And thanks to Ankita man and Neelkanthji and Raj Sab also, which they shared, and whatever we have adopted and we are doing, that I would like to share. Some part I can say what you rightly said, Agra is a very important city. From internationally, we are seeing the problems or complaint arises from the central and international tourist also. That basic problem is pollution. One side we want to develop city in all parameters, secondly the limitation of Taj Trapezium zone and Supreme Court so many policies, so that we are limited. Industrialization or development is restricted, but even then I can highlight some of the things related to in the region safe and equitable urban mobility. And you can see that under Agra Smart City, in order to enhance the urban mobility, what we have done is that in 63 junctions set up adaptive traffic control system. This adaptive traffic control system helps in actually monitoring the traffic at central level from the ICCC. And now this is adaptive traffic control system runs on three modes, I can say. One is 100% automatic mode. Second is, I can say, semi-automatic mode, where 50% time or hybrid automatic mode, you can say. And third is 100% manual mode. In that manner, it has a artificial intelligence and AI-based learning system. So based upon the traffic condition, it automatically determines the time. For example, that main crossing, one of the crossing in Agra is Hari Parvat city, from that is nearby to Municipal Corporation of Agra, is most important and busiest crossing of Agra. And what they did, that during peak hours, every time it shows that error. Because now we convert that system, which is automatical system, that we conducted that system in semi-hybrid. So that is controlled by manually from the control and command center. And there is a system for a green corridor also, as Mr. Raj was also sharing, that is everywhere in every smart city, because very frequent movement of VIPs in Agra. So green corridor also during the VIP movement, and ambulance when they passes through, that we are giving a green corridor. Green corridor can be set up along with a particular route also. And simultaneously, one thing that we are saying, that we are doing all the things for traffic management and safety. Another part, we require the tendency of Indian civilian, as you know, that they sometimes they compromises and they don't follow the traffic rules also. For that, through e-challan, that I can share the very, I can say the number, if you will see. From last 1.5 years, we started e-challan. From that period, in last 1.5 years, we have collected 11 crores 30 lakh rupees and 8,000 something rupees from e-challan, and which is sent to directly to the mobile number and the GR, which is raised, RC, which is raised on the whatsoever this address is mentioned on that. And second thing is this great boon for Agra in term of vehicle theft and blacklisted vehicle also. That is also taken care by this adaptive traffic system. And pollution level is also checked every time. And worse in time was that, so that Agra Smart City has taken the more than 100 electric buses, and which will start very soon, most probably in a month of January, and that pollution can be taken care. Because surrounding to Taj, as you know, 25 kilometer in radius, that industrial development is restricted, and even diesel, petrol, car and buses cannot be move around there. So that we are promoting to this public transport through electric buses. And 43 junctions, we have established emergency call box in this project, and taking care of the mission Shakti of UP government, and also taking care of the women's safety and women's in distress, can trust that button. And from there on, the action are taken to order to solve the particular issue of the incidents. and CCTV camera installed in more than 260 locations. So what happens is that it creates a sense of safety. Now the electric buses, which I have already told it to you, and advanced system, there we have put one more thing also, that is a panic button for the payment of safety. Also the woman of the during the traveling time, if any problem arises, that woman or any civilian can use that panic button also. An advanced system like a CCTV camera for the woman's safety and woman's for travel alone also, that is very useful, which is in term of an equitable urban mobility, and it will go to long way. The buses will be delivered most probably in the month of December and January, February. We are planning to start those electric buses. And as of now, that I can say, so many things are taking place regarding the controlling, like widening the roads, as Mr. Raj was saying, that everything was done. And we have given 52 cameras to police also. And the cameras are fixed on the number is given by the UP government to the police vehicles. The number is 112. If the person is giving a call, immediately police will reach within a 5 minutes. And those cameras are drone cameras and fixed onto the vehicle, which is provided by the government to the UP police. And these cameras are recording all the surrounding incidences, and that is controlled within a, I can say very soon, these things are taken care. And these are the things which are taken care by the Agra Smart Cities in terms of this. And secondly, the Forest Department, the task is giving every time more than 1 lakh plants in every season to municipal corporation. That is also done, and the drive is also done by local bodies, local, I can say, mayor of Agra, ki every they have given the number, so that every house they are providing the plants, and this is created at many levels. These are the things which are taken care by Agra Smart City, as well as I can say municipal corporation also.
Thank you, Dr. Bansal. That was quite comprehensive. I would be curious to know what are the first mile, last mile alternatives, green alternatives, which Agra is eventually going to come up with. Let me now go to Mr. Nilesh. We are seeing that cities are implementing different type of systems to solve for their challenges. They are bringing in technology. They are looking at technology delivering, the required outcomes for them. How do we see technology playing a role in defining future of cities? And how do we really see this whole connected universe in cities coming up together through, thinking through data, thinking through policy and things like that? How is this intelligent system going to deliver us that and to the policymakers too, very specifically?
Okay. Thank you so much for the question. I hope I'm audible. I had a lot of connectivity issue in between.
No, you're okay. Audible.
All right. Let me approach your question slightly differently in the sense that, coming from the background that I am coming from, I am a urban planner. I'm not an implementer, and I've been involved with the preparation of the Delhi Master Plan for 2041. And one of the things that we realized is that although the end results are required in terms of mobility, there's a lot of back-end planning, spatial planning that will have to back up the mobility results that we are really seeking in cities, and particularly connected mobility, which is to my mind quite critical. Because what's happening, for instance, is that transport often gets understood and implemented in extreme silos. There's a metro rail, there is a bus system. This is also true much more in the case of cities like Delhi, of course. In smaller cities, that's probably relatively better resolved. But in cities like Delhi, for example, there are around 27 different agencies looking at different aspects of transport in the city. Now, what happens is when a citizen experiences transport, a citizen is often experiencing transport as an end-to-end activity. So, for example, somebody could get out of their house, walk up to the nearest metro station, take a train, get off, take a bus to their workspace. So if we can reimagine transportation and planning around transportation as being able to facilitate this point-to-point service delivery for the citizen, I think that is one of the most critical imperatives that is facing cities today. Now, to do that, to my mind, three big areas in which I would like to quickly kind of get everybody's attention. Number one is a administrative challenge, is that if you have a number of agencies that are looking after transportation, how does one begin to integrate data systems around transportation? How does one begin to integrate spatial planning around transportation? How does one effectively manage last miles and so on and so forth? Who's really the custodian of the integration? I think is a question that might be an interesting one to discuss as part of this panel. So the first question really is administrative. The second is spatial planning, as we understand it, will also have to undergo a substantial change, transformation to be able to understand point-to-point connectivity. For example, you would have, as soon as one brings in the paradigm of point-to-point connectivity, one is then probably re-looking at areas around transit as places that become more walkable, they become more cyclable. Transit stations themselves start undergoing a transformation in the sense that they start transforming into multimodal hubs. One would imagine surrounding buildings undertaking some kind of concourse level integration. So, you know, the entire built structure of areas around transit begins to undergo a substantial change as soon as one begins to kind of draw the linkages between mobility and spatial planning, for instance. At a second level, you would also have to imagine that if you have to facilitate integrated transport, you also have to ensure that more and more people are beginning to live around transit. So the ministry, for example, is also pushing for transit-oriented development. And in addition to transit-oriented development, in general, I think moving from a monofunctional land use planning to a mixed-use planning base, I think provides a lot more options in terms of shortening trip distances, perhaps reducing the number of modal shifts that one has to undertake from one point to another. So mixed-use starts playing a very critical role in getting the mobility end result. The third is, once you start applying this layer, even data conversion starts changing. For example, you then start looking at, how do I facilitate a consumer leaving his house and reaching office to get an end-to-end information about, can I walk this distance? Something that Google, for instance, intuitively does right now. But we don't have enough data systems or governmental data systems integrated with information systems like Google to provide, for example, very clear bus route logic or rationalized logic of, how do I move from one point to another seamlessly with least challenges. And the last part really is about the larger built environment itself, is that the built environment will undergo fundamental changes. For example, if I'm talking about last mile connectivity, if I'm talking about improving walkability, then when I plan the entire area, I must look at walkable block lengths. You're not talking about long block lengths. You're looking at active frontages coming into play. You're looking at higher densities being planned around transit. You're talking about public space and market integration into the logic of streets. So there is a lot more parallel spatial planning buildup that is required for some of the mobility outcomes to really fructify, particularly around connectedness and efficiency. And the last very important point that I would like to make before I end is this whole idea that the belief that simply by improving public transport systems or improving the efficiency of systems, we might be able to pull citizens towards public transport or shared transport might not really play out, because there is a big behavioral issue that remains untackled in most of our planning discourse. And I think some regulatory measures in terms of really relooking at parking norms, relooking at how much we have supported private vehicle usage is something that we must think of as a part of an entire regulatory policy framework. I'll end at that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was very, very insightful. I think it was a power-packed 7 minutes delivered by you, and you said it all. I think that takes me to one more question to Ankita ma'am. Nilesh talked about imperative of how integration can happen, and hence We know for sure one agency within the city is not going to deliver end-to-end services. There are going to be multiple people involved in delivering different kind of services, ensuring that completes the journey for a person. Do you think now is the time to really look at a real interoperable platform which enables transport commerce to happen in a very independent manner? And much like SMTP to email, you know, you can send Gmail to Yahoo and Yahoo to Gmail. And similarly, should we now have a platform? Is that going to be one of those important things to do in cities?
Yes, Mr. Ogra, I was actually waiting for my turn very patiently because there are a couple of things, you know, which got left behind in my introductory comments. If you allow me, I'll just sort of first, before addressing the question, try to draw an imagery of the present day, you know, urban situation of Srinagar, and then say what we are trying to achieve through the, you know, the plans that we have in mind. So just imagine this, Srinagar, and I'm talking entirely from the urban mobility perspective. We have a, you know, ancient, nice, beautiful city with a connection of a NH44, with a road network which goes out radially. We have something like 5 bus terminals. We have ROW, as you rightly mentioned, less than 20 meters. We have not very active inland waterways, right? We have a lot of buses with, you know, unorganized bus sector, I would say, with people, you know, who genuinely travel by them having the knowledge in a way. A lot of private players, we have our government players also. What I'm trying to basically draw out is the fact that right now, as is the case with most, you know, urban sort of development somewhere, you know, when you're developing, you're not yet there in the entire thing. So we have multiple players, stakeholders in the urban transport sector, probably not talking to each other, right? Why is, and here again, I have to focus on the fact that, you know, a lot of people think that MRTC is just about metro. Metro is something that we are just taking as the baseline to sort of grow radially and sort of plan out the whole thing. You talked about inter-transport commerce, if that's what I got right, right? There's something called the transit-oriented development, which also we intend to do. And how we intend to do is by bringing these metro corridors as the focus of the transit-oriented development. There are plans of convergence of the multiple stakeholders, which are in the discussion stage right now, leading to some very good discussion points out there. And I believe an agenda of action plan is, you know, you will very soon see what convergence is probably going to happen. Now, let me just come to metro for a second, right? The socio-economic benefits of a metro system is probably known to everyone. One of the speakers rightly mentioned that maybe sometimes it is not well utilized. Yes, it might not be well utilized in the very beginning, as we saw with the most successful metro at the moment, which is the DMRC model, the Delhi Metro model. But it is only a matter of time when people understand the benefit of converting to the metro, where you have a card, you swipe it, and you get in. And there is this secure, and one of the questions that I believe your team had sent me was also about the security angle, right? Okay. So let me tell you very, very categorically that that is an aspect that we have fully in mind, right? We want people to feel more secure in our public transport because of the number of layering of, you know, security that we intend to have, then they own private vehicles, right? Also, let's try and understand the security part of it from also another aspect, which is the accidents. You know, I believe there are quite a few road accidents that can be averted if one goes into this public transport mode. Having said that, it's going to be quite interesting to see how Srinagar, you know, reacts to this whole I would not say 24-hour model, but what we are intending to have is around 17 hours a day of public transport, which I believe should be sufficient for Srinagar. And also, an interesting point is that when the team, which we had sort of got into action to find out, you know, the field results in a way, found out that the peak traffic speed usually is below 20 kilometers an hour. But in our case, what is going to happen is it's going to touch 30 kilometers an hour. And I believe that, that's going to be a game changer. Yeah, that's a game changer. And yeah, so these are some of the things. Another thing I wanted to mention was that if we continue with the buses at the moment, only the buses, I mean, buses, of course, have to be there. You know, it's all about intermodal integration and all those things. But as, you know, if we just continue with the model, which is there right now, we're probably touching a PHPDT figures of 5,000, right? Mm-hmm. And if we move to the metro model, we can actually accommodate around 15,000. So that's another game changer.
Absolutely.
Another interesting aspect is the transit-oriented development is something, again, very close to our heart. Now, let's not think of metro just as metro. We want to sort of capture those, you know, the socioeconomic benefits, the financial benefits, create a revenue model. So anything that is around that particular stretch would also mean it getting converted to some kind of commercial, you know, aspect. I'll be honest with all of you that we are at the stage of, you know, understanding more of it, how we can go ahead. But it is definitely one of the visions that we have. So, Ograji, is there anything else that I probably missed, you know, that you would want to hear from?
And I think, you know, it does give a sense of how deeply you're thinking about bringing it as a right mode choice to the people of Srinagar. And also, how do you want to link it in a manner that it becomes relevant to different kind of people who are going to use it? Tourists being one of those important users, and how easily they can travel within Srinagar city to look at different places within the city. And maybe this becomes one of those things that tourists see as a credible mode of movement within the city. I think that's so nice to see, ma'am. One last question I'll like to ask Mr. Raj. Are you available? Okay, it seems we have some connection issue here. One last question, maybe, you know, I can direct again to you, ma'am. Because it's something that is very, very important. You touched upon the security, usability, accessibility. How are we ensuring that, you know, this is provided to all, given the kind of security situation that we have in the city, where internet access might not be available at the speeds that are required, to really see the change happening with the help of smartphones. How is that being looked at for the city?
Right. So, Ograji, this is definitely something that people often ask. Let me tell you, it will be state of the art. Everything, you know, without committing in this open forum, everything that needs to be done will be done. And let me also tell something to the live audience that a lot of people don't know this, but, you know, the ethos of Srinagar and the ethos of Kashmir is actually to protect things which are meant for the economic growth of that region. So I truly believe that it is just the initial teething issues that might, you know, be faced by us in the beginning, which could be variant. It could be anything. Right. It could be security. It could be, you know, like even the basic technological teething. We are trying to safeguard against all of that because, you know, we are trying as best as we can. But it's just a matter of time before this thing is going to catch up. Like I said, I had the figures, but I'm not, you know, getting into the numbers of it. By the time we reach 2044, the population, the working population, people who would like to travel from one corner of the city to the other, that's going to be substantial in number. And at the moment, if I look at the numbers which are in front of me, the vehicular traffic is entirely mostly, 79% of the trips, it says here, is vehicular trips. And 21% are walk trips, for example. Then, anything that is so, required and which is so important for the city's growth, I feel the place itself will protect it, is my optimistic feeling. Having said that, we do have enough precautions, state of the art, that is intended to ensure that this whole, this whole segment is going to be protected. So I think I will not reveal more than this. It should be enough for
that's good of an good of an answer. So basically, you're using technology a lot to really get it rightly delivered to the people. I think we are actually short of time. I would like to have closing remarks from all the panelists, and then I can kind of summarize the whole discussion and close the panel discussion. We can start with Mr. Raj Cherubal.
I think, yeah. So, closing remark, it's beautiful to see so much happening around the country, and it's very heartening to see what others are doing. And like I said, yesterday there was a seminar, and I said the same thing, that we learned a lot from other cities. Like when we started some of the work here in Smart City, we ended up going to Bangalore, we ended up going to Pune, and so many other places. And various conferences like this one arranged by Smart City and others. So we clearly learned a lot, and I'm very thankful that you guys have organized this. I hope, but we have a long way to go. As I think all the discussion shows, there's so much to do, and just hardly started much work, no matter how much work is happening. So I hope many more such gatherings happen, and continue to learn from others. And hopefully others can come in Chennai and see some of the work we've done, and similarly, we get to go other places and see what others have done and learn. So thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Dr. Rohit Bansal, closing remarks from you.
Very good, very interactive session. Vivek, you dealt with a very smooth manner. And thanks to Fahim, again, I will request, this is a very good sharing platform. And a lot of things I have seen that Ankita Madam has shared regarding the technology which they are adopting in J&K especially, and similarly Mr. Raj, whatsoever they are doing in Chennai, and Mr. Neelkant in Pimpri. And it is exchange of knowledge is always required, which cannot be done by seeing the city or state only. So that I am really thankful for conducting a such kind of important and knowledge sharing meeting. Thanks.
Thank
a
you.
Lot.
Mr. Neelkanta, closing remarks from you, please.
Thank you, Mr. Vivek. Such a wonderful event organized by this group. And I learned so many best practices and best cases from this Madam Ankita and this Dr. Bansal, sir. So, my sincere is for the sustainable transport. We must take the different stories, success stories, and we start to share to each other cities, and the sustainable transport and one of the most important issues nowadays, and technology driven city. So we are always saying that our country is a developing country, but we should move by the developed countries by the way of the successful this transport system. Thank you.
Thank you. Ma'am, closing remarks from you.
I had an absolutely fantastic time listening to everyone in the panel discussion today. The reason being is most of the time we work within our little chambers. We are just looking at our own, way of thinking. And when you have this kind of interactive sessions, you truly believe that, there's so much happening, and there might be best practices which probably, we need to also learn from. So today has been truly motivating for me, and thank you so much for having me, and hope to see all of you soon again somewhere sometime. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I just have two or three things to say before we close. There are two or three things which kind of stuck with me. One was holistic view of change is what we should really look at. Second was provide incentives, enforce strongly, which I could hear from the panelists. And some of those things which are linked to administrative thinking, special planning, link it to the urban structure, understand the urban fabric. I think we are slowly inching towards the right things. It's just that we need to get our holistic thinking in place, and different constituents of the city have to work together to deliver the future of cities to us. Thank you so much for contributing to the panel today.
Thank you, Mr. Ogra. Thank you, Mr. Ogra, for a fantastic moderation of a great panel. Actually, I'll say, to him, it's like there was a lot to learn from this panel about various mobility aspects, be it like what are the future and how the cities are implementing, and what some of the cities which have already done some great work under it, and how Srinagar, ma'am, you are really good in talks in terms of what exactly you're trying to portray and what you're trying to talk about the mobility system. So I'd we have got small because this is a digital forum, so we are giving digital speaker certificates. So I'll request my backend team to start with first Ankita Khar, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for
being
part of
it. Thank you so much. Unanticipated and truly, truly memorable. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is for Dr. Rohit Bansal. Thank you, sir. It's been so many years you have been with us, participating in our events, giving us some of your valuable times. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you, Fahim. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Next to Mr. Nilesh. Mr. Nilesh?
He's left. I think he's not there.
So, Raj Charibal has also left. So, the last, I would request my backend team to present it to Mr. Vivek Ogra, who was a fantastic moderator for today. Thank you, Mr. Vivek. Thank you so much. And we look forward to all of you to be on our platform for the next event. When we do, we'll surely get in touch with you and invite you for another great session. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Pleasure is all mine. Thank you.